Hello world, my name is Nick360 and welcome to The Complete Beginner's Guide to Prison Architect Campaign Mode. In the last episode we completed Chapter 1, Death Row. Now let us move on to Chapter 2, Palermo. I always want to say Palmero, but it's Palermo. A massive fire has destroyed this prison's kitchen and canteen. We need to take care of the fire. Oh look, a fire! There's a fire brewing! Okay, it's a fire. I'm going to skip this cutscene. So I'm going to hit spacebar right away to pause the game, otherwise the fire will spread. Now that the fire isn't spreading, we have some time to think. Now that we have some time to think, the first priority is calling 911. Or more specifically, calling the fire people. So we're going to click on emergencies and fire engine. Let's call both of them. 1, 2. So where's the firemen? Well, they're right here on the side of the road. And we have to tell them where to go. So there's two ways you can get the firemen to move. You can click and drag them, and then left click. I'm going to left click it right here. Another way is you can click on this box here. And done. Now we're sending them in. They're going to take out the fire. Make sure you don't send them directly into the fire, because they're not fireproof. They will burn up and die if they're standing directly in the fire. So kind of put them off a little bit away to the fire. And the fire will spread by the time they get there, so Just be careful. Don't send them right up to the edge of the fire, because that could cause problems. And they will automatically start spraying water on the fire once they get to where they want to go. So right here, if they're nearby the fire, they're going to start spraying the water. Once the firemen are standing still and you have them selected, you can also control where they shoot the water by holding down H. So let's say I want to shoot the water behind me, even though there's no fire there, I can hold H. And then I'm shooting the water where my mouse is pointing. I want them to move closer to the fire, so that they can put it out. And we're going to look at our other patrol here. They took out the fire by the entrance, so we're going to come in this building here and finish out clearing the fire from this room. And if you look at this, like even this small fire here, there's like kind of like smoldering coals, that still counts as fire. And all of the small coals has to be extinguished. Even though all the big flames are out, even the small ones have to be taken out before we can move on in the tutorial. And so you just slowly move your firemen around. Alright, it looks like this room is clear of fire, so we can move this group over here to take out the fire in this room. Now, if this fighting the fire is going a little slow, you can speed up time a little bit by holding this double arrow, and that will double the speed of the game. There we go, I think that's it. Oh, they just have that one small flame in the corner. I'm going to select these firemen, help out. Here, go over here and extinguish that flame. There we go, that last flame has been extinguished, now the entire fire is out. My god, there's a survivor in the wreckage! I'm just going to skip that there, but all you needed to know is that he is a mob boss, and none of the prisoners are going to be happy that he's really injured. Also, our kitchen and our canteen has been destroyed, and now all our prisoners are going to be very hungry. So we need to completely demolish those rooms so that we can build new ones. I said demolish again, I keep saying that. Anyway, this is going to be the garbage zone where we're going to dump the trash from the burned down building. And the firemen we're going to send home, because we don't need them anymore. Yeah, I'm just being mean for no reason. Let's just send them home. You can hit on the X right here, those two X's, and now they'll wrap up their hoses that they use to spray the water, and they'll leave, and as soon as they leave the bottom of the screen, they'll have been sent home. Meanwhile, we need to get rid of these two buildings, so we're going to go to Foundations and Bulldoze to completely demolish the buildings. So we're going to demolish this one, and we're going to demolish this one here. And I know it's going to be coming up, so I'm going to, in advance, build another small building here. There we go. It's going to be about 15 by 15. And the CEO is telling us something. Demolishing those buildings will take a while. You can pass the time more quickly using the buttons under the clock. So that's the fast forward button. But the funny thing is, it was already fast forward, but every time he calls you, it moves it back down to normal speed. So you have to keep moving it back up. Also, one quick thing here, this is a little extra thing. This is a photograph. You click on it, and you unlock this photograph. And some of them are on the ground, but most of them you unlock through playing through the story mode. Anyway, let's speed up time. And let's see, we can hire more workers. Now if you look in the infirmary here, this is where our injured prisoner is, but we don't have any doctors, so we need to hire some doctors. Two doctors should be enough, but let's just get four just for kicks and giggles. We have a lot of money, so we can afford to have a lot of extra workmen. So I'm going to hire 40 to 50 workmen. Actually, I'm just 50. And so I'm just hiring more and more, and every time I hire them, I have to spend $500, and they decrease how much money I make per day. So you can see more. Oh, I got 57. That's a lot more than I expected. Either way, I'm still making money. I'm also going to hire more guards. And 35, 40 guards. Also, we're just going to do 10 gardeners and 10 janitors. This will greatly help the prison be clean. You can see the gardeners are cleaning up the leaves and the moss and all the other stuff, and the janitors are going to clean up the gunk in the showers. If you look in the showers, there's all this crap on the ground, and the janitors will slowly clean it up. So just hiring some extra people will greatly improve the quality of your prison. Now we need to go to rooms, and we need to designate a garbage zone. So we're going to designate this garbage zone here, and as soon as we do so, there we go. Now there's a place to put the garbage. So our workmen can take the trash bags from this demolished area and move it into this garbage zone, which will be taken away by trucks. The CEO is calling us. Good work! Let's check up on our casualty. And now it's clean. Our janitors cleaned the infirmary, so now it's nice and not smelly anymore. Meanwhile, our prisoner is not doing so well. He's turned into a villain from the Batmans. Anyways, two good-for-nothing sons and sons-in-laws are coming to visit him. And, oh, I think he's trying to say something. Which one of you losers did this?
No one did this to you, Pappy. It was an accident.
Shut your stinking mouth and listen good, the both of you. If I knew which one of you losers started that fire, I'd snap your stinking neck. But my time's done. I'm gonna die in this chair. And this family business to attend you, being a mob boss and all. The Palermo name is all we got left. So do the honorable thing, you losers. Capiche?
We know what to do, pups.
Yeah, these cutscenes are kind of cute because if you look what's actually happening on the screen, it's these little cartoon characters that are like not much better. Like, they're not even like animated properly. But then you have these cool pictures, and the pictures show a much more graphic and a much more detailed story of what's happening.
Eh, watch your back!
This isn't over, Nico.
Uh-oh. Looks like some fighting is about to occur in our prison, especially since we do not have food for our prisoners to eat, and that's what the CEO is telling us.
Without food, these inmates will be tearing down the walls within a week. We gotta secure the prison before we end up with a riot on our hands. This is the deployment screen. From here, you control the tactical deployment of all your guards. Deploy a spread of guards to all cell blocks and rooms. Assign 10 guards to stations around the prison. That should be a sufficient show of force. And I want a patrol around the inner courtyard. Anytime you're unsure what to do, look up a tutorial on YouTube, such as this one you're watching right now.
So the courtyard is this area right here. And if we go to deployment, we can see that there's different rooms. So this is a room, this is a room, this is a room. And every time I put my mouse over it, it kind of highlights it with this striped pattern. So if you click on guards and then click on a room, this will allow you to station a guard there. And what a station means is hang out this area and just make sure nothing bad happens. So if I click on it, I've queued up one guard to stay in this area and be stationed here. And I hit play. Then one guard has been selected out of my 40 guards, and it's this guard in particular, and he's now stationed, or she is now stationed. She's going to walk into the cell block, and she's going to stand around there and just make sure nothing bad happens. And I can do this for all the cell blocks. So I can put a guard here, I can put a guard here, I can put a guard in the holding cell. I'm going to want to put a guard in this entryway because that's a very easy way for prisoners to escape if it's unguarded. I can put a guard in this cell block. I can do one in this cell block. I'm going to want to have two in the infirmary because our mob boss is in there. We want to make sure he's safe, slash he doesn't escape. We're going to put one in each of the yards. And there we go. That is at least 10 guards. Now for patrols, it's a little different. Patrols is walk back and forth along a line. So you click and drag, and that's the line you want them to walk across. And so I want the guards to walk back and forth across this line. Now how many guards? I click on the line, and there I have stationed a guard on this line. But instead of just walking around aimlessly, they'll walk back and forth on this line. And I can change the path of this line. So I can make this kind of S shape here, and so they'll keep walking back and forth. Or I can make a circle. I can make a circle around this building that I'm building to make sure that the workers are safe. So I could do that. So I could put one guard on this path around this building that we've just built, and one on this inner courtyard. And there we go. That is our two guards in the inner courtyard.
We got a lot of work to do. We need to turn our attention to replacing the kitchen and canteen. First, we need to rebuild the kitchen. And once that's done, we need to build a canteen. And when you have that completed, the chefs will automatically start preparing meals for the entire prison. If you aren't sure what to do, look up a tutorial. Yeah, okay. And so here's all the instructions right here. I'm not going to minimize them, but normally I like to minimize it. So we have a building here. So it needs an entrance, and all the entrances are in the objects tab.
In objects, we can just look for a door, so D-O-O-R, door, and we're going to put one on either side, so one here and one here. Meanwhile, we're going to put another building right underneath it that is a nice 15 by 15 building, or 16 by 16, and then we're going to do a 16 long and all the way from here wide. There we go. So this is going to be our canteen on the right, and this is going to be, half of this room is going to be our kitchen. We're going to leave some room for another room here. And this is going to serve another purpose. And this is going to be our common room and laundry room. And we'll cover those two rooms in a little bit. So we need some doors. And I don't want prisoners getting in the kitchen, so I'm going to use the staff door. Prisoners cannot go through staff doors by themselves. They need a staff member to allow them to go through. So we're just going to staff door in this room where the kitchen's going to be, so they can't get in the kitchen. And a normal door so they can get into the canteen. Because it wouldn't make sense if they were not allowed to get into the canteen without extra permission. That kind of doesn't make a lot of sense. And because I have so many extra workers, even on normal speed, they're building this quite fast. Now, before the buildings are built, we're going to need to hook up the utilities. So remember how there's lights in all the buildings? Well, those lights need power. Now, remember, each light doesn't have to be directly hooked up to the power. It just has to be in the flow. So if I put this cable here and go along the center of the room, that should have the flow of power fill the entire room. So we shouldn't have to worry about that. Likewise, we can go through the kitchen, and we're going to go through this common room and laundry room. Now, this pipe has been broken here, so we're going to repair that. And then I'm going to extend this pipe all the way up and connect it to this pipe here. I'm going to send this pipe down and then connect it to this pipe here. So now all our pipes will be connected. And we'll give our workers some time to do that. Now that the building's foundations have been complete, all these walls have been automatically put around the buildings, so we can now designate the rooms. So we need a kitchen and canteen. So canteen is going to be this whole room here, and we're going to click and drag across the entire room. We can go outside the bounds, and it'll be smart enough to figure out, oh yeah, I can only put the canteen inside. And the kitchen is going to go right here, and there we go. There is our kitchen. And staff, we're going to need a bunch of cooks. So I'm going to hire 10 cooks. I think you need 8 to meet the requirement, but 10, 11, whatever, that's going to be much better. All right, improve the kitchen floor. Now we do that as a materials, and we're just going to do a nice tile floor because tile makes sense in the kitchen, and then marble is a nice floor for a canteen. And we have so many workers, this should go by pretty quickly. Now I'm just going to speed up time. And now our workers are going to go extra fast, going in and out, repairing the floors, putting in the utilities, putting in the pipes. Now, our kitchen has to have 3 things in it to meet its requirements. It needs a cooker, a fridge, and a sink. The fridge is going to store the food right before it gets cooked. The cooker cooks the food and makes it ready to eat. And the sink cleans up the dishes from the meals. So, I mean, that kind of makes sense. Every kitchen kind of has those 3 things. And, of course, everything's in objects. Now, because we designated this as a kitchen, we can zoom in on it and it will highlight the things that belong in the kitchen. So here's our cooker. So we're just going to place some cookers. I'm going to place 5, and I'm going to click and hold 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then for fridges, I like to have 2 fridges for every cooker. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oops, not that one. 9, 10. Now we have those. Now we have our fridges queued up, and our workers are beginning to install the cookers. Finally, we need some sinks. And so I'm going to install 1, 2, 3 sinks. Now we've built so many cookers and refrigerators that we overpowered our generator. So we need to build some more capacitors. So we go to utilities, that's where the capacitors are. I have so much money, I can put capacitors all the way around this power station. Now I hit escape. Now these doors right here are jail doors. So our workers are going to get stuck. We can just right click on this door right here and we can open it for our workers. We can also left click on it and force it open right there like that. And then the door will stay open. I personally just like using the right click method to open the doors. There we go. It's a much, much safer way to do it because then you don't forget to leave it open. And now that the capacitor's around the power station, we turn this back on and boom, now our prison has power again. Now we need to hurry up because our prisoners are getting hungry and it's mealtime. So we need serving tables. So we're going to put 1, 2, 3 serving tables, and this is where they'll pick up the food and the tray. Then we need a place for them to eat. So you need a table and a bench. So the table's where they eat and the bench is where they sit down. So we're gonna put a table right here, right here, and we put 2 benches around it. So one bench on either side and a bench on either side. And that should get built. And I can build another table and chairs right here, right next to it. And I just like to leave a little bit of space between. Oops, that's not a little bit of space between. I like to, for realistic sake, put in a little bit of room. So 1, 2, 3. You can do this however you want, as long as you can put in a bunch of tables and chairs. And once there is a table, bench, and serving table, the canteen will meet its requirements. So what's going to happen is the chefs are going to bring in food from deliveries delivered on trucks. They're going to bring it all the way to the kitchen. They're going to store the food in the fridge. Once the food's in the fridge, they'll wait until 4 hours before mealtime, in which case they'll start cooking the food. Once the food has been prepared, a cook will bring the pots of food to the serving table and put it down on the serving table. And then prisoners will go grab a tray, grab the food, and sit down on the table and eat. And that's how food works in Prison Architect. Over here we have yet another photo, a Polaroid, of prisoners enjoying a meal in the cafeteria. So we need to put some garbage bins into our kitchen and our canteen. They're not strictly necessary, but it keeps everything cleaner. So we're going to put some garbage cans right here. And then also along this wall here. And likewise, I'm going to put some around the exit here. And then kind of by each of the serving tables. There we go. That's plenty of bins in the kitchen and the canteen. Now these sinks need water to work. And so we can do that in utilities. And we can just use a small pipe. And each sink needs to have a small pipe underneath it. And we'll just connect it to the big pipe right here. And now our sinks are going to be piped up as soon as our workers can get around to it. Now while they're doing this, I'm going to go and make this a common room. So I'm going to go to room, common room, and if you can't, it's right here, but if you can't see it, you can just type in common room. Oops, that's not how you spell common room. Common room. I'm going to make roughly half of this the common room. And what the common room is, it's a place where the prisoners are allowed to relax and kind of have fun. And it's not going to be like a sports bar. It's going to be a lot less luxurious than a sports bar, but it's still going to be better than nothing. So we're going to go to objects, and we can put all these different objects in here. So we can put phone booths, and so that our prisoners can call their family members, and so they won't feel so lonely. We could put in a pool table, or two or three. Pool table, two or three. We could put in a TV. We can put in a TV so they can watch some TV. We can put in a radio so they can listen to the radio. And of course, we can put in a bunch of chairs. And important to have chairs in your common room, and we'll learn why in a moment. But put around 8 chairs in your common room, just so that it has chairs. If it doesn't have chairs, the common room won't be able to serve its purpose very well. Now, if your prison's like mine, there might be these extra wires that you don't like. You can dismantle the wires by going to Dismantle Utility and just selecting the wires you want to get rid of, and then they won't be in your way anymore. So in Utilities mode, you don't have to worry about them. All right, now all our sinks are piped up. Here's the call from the CEO. You would not believe what I've just been told. Let me guess, there's drugs in the food. There's drugs in the food. Yay! Or not yay. I mean, yay for the prisoners, because they really enjoy drugs. But we are the people controlling the prison, and we don't like drugs in our prison because they cause our prisoners to do crazy stuff, and that's not what we want. Oh, here is our mob boss before they were in jail. Don Victor Palermo, boss of one of the East Coast's most feared mob families. He has 2 sons and a son-in-law and a daughter. Da-da-da-da-da. And then I'm skipping these cutscenes because you don't really need to know this for a tutorial. But wait, Edward from chapter 1 killed the son of the mob boss. How was the man cheating on Edward's wife? Was the son of this mob boss? Unfortunately for the family, the police found 12 kilos of uncut cocaine or whatever drug in this bag right here. And the evidence led straight to the top. Now the whole family's being arrested. His son-in-law, his son who's still alive, but the daughter... The daughter did not get arrested. We don't know much about her other than she was kept outside the family business. So, I mean, that's why she's not getting arrested. It's not because she's a girl. It's because she wasn't involved in the criminal activities. But someone on the outside must have been sending those drugs in. Or maybe she was getting involved in those criminal activities. Who knows? We're going to maybe learn more at the end of this chapter. We're going to have a serious narcotics problem on our hands here. We can't deal with that yet. We gotta get our kitchen canteen up and running. Our chefs will work on preparing food for everyone, which should cool things down. But I'm concerned the fire was clearly deliberate, and we don't want a repeat of that. Install a sprinkler system over in the new kitchen and canteen and connect them with the water mains. All prisoners have needs. Those needs directly impact how your prisoners behave. That makes very sense. You know, if they don't have food, they're going to be very angry. When there's more of the food, that will affect how they behave, and we can look at them based on their needs. Well, remember, right now everyone's hungry, so everyone's being shouting and being very angry. Food is their highest priority need, and ignoring it will be a huge mistake. You can monitor their needs in the needs report. And so this is the needs report. It opened up automatically for us, and we can see the needs such as sleep, bowels, and bladder. Those are being met, but things like food, recreation, and clothing are not being met very well. And if you look down here, there's the key. The closer to red it is, the worse the need is being met. And if it's green, that means prisoners are satisfied. So right now, almost all our prisoners are satisfied in sleep, bowels, and bladder. And almost none of our prisoners are satisfied with food or clothing or recreation. As you expect, food is virtually red for everyone, you know, not having a canteen. Your decision as the resident prison architect, which needs you will try to attend to first. You can install television in the cells. Yeah, we're not going to install televisions in the cells. That's why I built the common room. So that's one community place for all the prisoners to hang out. You could hire some janitors to clean the place up. We already did the janitors. Actually, if we didn't hire janitors, the environment would have been terrible. Remember how gunky the prison was before? Well, that actually would affect the prisoners' behavior. And so we want them to behave nicer, so we hire some janitors so that the prison looks cleaner and the prisoners behave better. Are we going to just ignore the prisoner needs and then use force to keep them in the control? That isn't a great option. You don't want to have to rely on force, although sometimes using force is an important tool. I'll leave it up to you. Alright, so because, I'm just going to pause for a second, because I put in this common room, we have a bunch of prisoners playing pool and watching TV and listening to the radio, and so a lot of prisoners are meeting the recreation need. And prisoners who are working on their needs at this time is going to be blue. So you can see a bunch of prisoners are working on their recreation need. So that's why I built the common room, is because I know we need to be able to take care of our recreation need. And I hired those janitors, so that was the environment need. Now food is going to be a big problem. Because right now, even though we have a bunch of serving tables with food in it and a bunch of cookers, fridges, and sinks, not all prisoners are being fed. And the reason why is because the prisoners don't have a place to sit down during mealtime. So we need to build more tables. Now each bench can hold 4 prisoners. And so each table has 2 benches around it. That means each table can hold 8 prisoners. And so right now, if I fill this entire canteen with tables and benches, like I'm doing so right now, then we should be able to have all the prisoners be able to eat all at once. But before we finish the canteen, we need to put sprinklers in. And I like putting the sprinklers up on the wall because that kind of is where sprinklers are in real life. So I'm just going to put a couple, I'm going to put a sprinkler kind of in each corner. So up on the wall in each corner. I'm going to do that for this room. I'm going to put that one in the kitchen, 2 in the kitchen. I'm going to put 2 in the common room. This is going to be the laundry room, so I'm going to put some in the laundry room here. And there we go. Now, and then we're going to put some in the bottom of the kitchen as well. And I'm actually going to separate this into 2 rooms here. So on the top room is going to be the kitchen, and we're going to make another room down here that's going to serve an important purpose in our prison. Likewise, I'm going to put the walls here to separate this into another room. And the other room we're going to make is a laundry room. The laundry room is right here, but if you have trouble looking for it, laundry. And laundry room. This is going to be our laundry room. There's going to be a wall here. And once the wall's built, you can't get into the laundry room. So you have to remember to put a door. Otherwise, prisoners won't be able to get in. So door right there. We can just quickly put the things in the laundry room, such as the washing machines to wash the clothes. The ironing boards to fold the clothes. And just you don't need that many, just 3. And then some baskets. And right here, just going to put in a bunch of baskets so that the clean clothes can be delivered to the prisoners. There we go. So now we got a laundry room and common room, and we have this pole right here of prisoners hanging out in the common room. All right, this kitchen is being modified. We're getting another door for this room right underneath our kitchen so that we can get in it once this wall has been built. And now look, now that we have all these tables and benches around our canteen, you can see we have a lot more room for prisoners to sit down and eat. And if we click on prisoners and then go to the needs tab, we can see that the food need is going down, and it's gone down by a lot. So the food need is almost completely taken care of. And so every meal, our prisoners will be satisfied. Now recreation still needs to be addressed, and clothing needs to be addressed. Another way to look at how well you're doing in managing your needs of the prisoners is in the top left. This is kind of a thermometer, which keeps track of the temperature of the prison. Not the physical temperature, but how angry everyone is. And right now, the danger level is medium, but it's going down. And so right now, 24 prisoners have serious complaints. So 24 prisoners have needs that are seriously unmet. And that's going to be the recreation need. Now right now, it just switched to free time and our schedule, which is right here, right under this clock that says 10:05, 10:06. That's our schedule. And we can change that. But since recreation is a need that's very much unmet. Prisoners are, of course, going to have a tendency to want to go into the common room. So I might put in another radio or another pool table just so that prisoners can meet their needs more easily. But look, it's going down. The danger level is decreasing by a lot. It's actually going down by really fast. So that's good. We don't want high-level danger in your prison. The higher the danger level in your prison, the more likely fights are going to start and bad things are going to happen. So, of course, we put all these sprinklers in, but sprinklers, surprise, they need water. So we just need to put one pipe underneath each of the sprinklers and make sure that that pipe is connected to one of the big pipes. So right there, it has to be actually underneath the sprinkler. So this won't work, but that will work. It needs to be underneath. So we can put one all the way here, all the way, here. And we need to make sure it's connected to a big pipe, otherwise it won't receive any water. Likewise, our washing machines need water as well, and they also need power as well. They need power directly hooked up to this. So lights don't need power directly hooked up, but washing machines do need power directly hooked up. Likewise, the cookers and the fridges also need to be directly hooked up to the power. All right, we're getting a call from the CEO.
You've been shown an admirable dedication in taking care of your prisoners' needs. Well done. You've probably noticed by now that the major remaining gripe among prisoners is a lack of clean clothing. If you want to take care of this need, you need to run a laundry service to gradually produce clean clothes. Build a laundry and hire more janitors to start providing clean laundry for our inmates. Well, we're almost close. We just need to get our washing machines to start working. And, that's basically just wait until our workers get everything installed. So we can just triple time accelerate and our workers are going to get everything installed.
So right now I put two sprinklers in the kitchen and four sprinklers in the canteen. You need at least two in each. So four in the canteen is more than enough. And the two that I have in the kitchen will be enough. But they do need to be piped up. Because if they're not piped up, they're not functional. And the game won't count that as good enough. You can't just put the sprinkler in and then... Basically, you can't put a fake sprinkler in. You can't put a sprinkler that doesn't have any water being able to come out of it. That's cheating. And here we go, we got our cooks cleaning dishes. And so of course, we could have put another sink right here and the dishes will be cooked and the dishes will be cleaned even faster. And there we go, our laundry room is now completely operational. So our janitors, when they find the time, they'll come in. Oops, let's go this to normal speed. They'll take clean clothes and they'll put it in this basket here. And then they'll go to the cell block here and they'll put clean clothes on all the prisoners' beds. So there we go, we got nice clean folded clothes on all these prisoners' beds. So after their shower in the morning, they'll be able to, you know, take their towel, walk to their cell, and they'll get to put on a fresh clean uniform. Nice and probably still warm from the dryer. So satisfying the needs of our prisoners are going to make them feel better. And if the prisoners feel better, they're going to behave more appropriately. They'll get into less fights, they'll cause less trouble, which is exactly what we want in our prison. Now I'm going to extend this cables here to provide power to this room right here. And of course, we need water for the sprinklers right here. I'm putting sprinklers in every room. You don't have to, but we have some known arsonists in our prison, and that's a good idea to have sprinklers in every room when you know the people are going to want to set things on fire. And I'm getting a call from the CEO.
We've had an incident in the showers.
So normally clicking on a Polaroid will be at the end of the chapter, but I know through experience that this is not the end of the chapter Polaroid. This is a cutscene in the middle of the chapter. So I'm going to try and do all these optional objectives. So I'm comfortable clicking on this Polaroid. We're going to look at the tape of what happened. Click on the Polaroid and we begin our cutscene here. And we got people in the shower. Oh no, someone has a knife.
Alone, perfect.
There's no drains in the shower, so water's just spilling on the floor everywhere. This is a very poorly designed shower.
You took your time!
Cut the crap! I never did know what my loser sister saw in you! This her idea? Off the old man?
Is that what you think, you fat loser? I didn't mean for him to get hurt. I love him like he's my own father. I'm sick of seeing this family brought down by your stupidity. The fire was meant for you!
Oh no!
Then consider this repairing the favor!
Dun 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 dun.
Don't come the saint, we both know you plan to take me out one day.
Uh-oh, you see the guy sneaking up? I don't know why I didn't just stab him already, I mean they're just standing right face to face and no one's being stabbed.
Yeah, you always were such a smart guy, Nico. And look where got you, don't worry, you won't feel a thing.
It's a knife, of course he's gonna feel a thing. It's you that I'd be worried about.
I told you, watch your back!
Schwink! Ching, 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 ching.
Uh-oh, someone is bleeding a lot, you know, with taking a wire to the neck. Okay, skip through this as much as possible. He's getting blood everywhere.
Have you met Frankie before? He's got a unique talent with a piano wire.
Oh, is he piano tunist? I like the piano. That's one of my favorite instruments.
Oh, look.
That's not the sound he's probably making. It's probably more like... because he's getting choked to death with piano wire. But he has a knife. And maybe he'll use that knife for something maybe a little bit dangerous.
Honestly, by the time he's finished, they'll think it was suicide.
Oh, you're gonna regret saying that, Nico.
Ah!
Stab.
Ah, I've been stabbed, and now I'm unconscious.
Uh-oh. The two people are seriously hurt.
But he stabs he stabbed the piano tunist. Dang it!
Okay, they're bleeding. One's bleeding out, and dead. And we have another person. He's bleeding out, and dead. And Nico survived. He's seriously hurt, but he survived. We're just going to skip the rest of the cutscene, because that's pretty much all that happened.
You can bet that the mob has been selling drugs to all the prisoners here. The guards are telling me they've seen a lot of prisoners showing signs of withdrawal since the fire. I want you to search every prisoner in every cell. I bet we can find drugs all over the prison.
Deaths, two today. And if we highlight over deaths, we can see where the deaths are, and that's right here in the prison. So fortunately, we have some janitors, so they'll be able to clean the blood up. And there should be a hospital car coming here from the top, an ambulance, and they can put the dead bodies in there, and then they'll take the dead bodies away. So eventually the bodies will be taken care of. Meanwhile, we have a couple things that we want to do. If you look at the top right, we have 99 prisoners, but we have room for 87, so we don't have enough room. Whoops! Now we can prevent this from happening in the future by clicking on prisoners, going to intake, and clicking none. So now we're going to take in no additional prisoners. Then we're going to need more beds. So go to objects, beds, and this is a holding cell. So this is where prisoners who do not have their own cell stay. So we can just put some more beds in the holding cell. We can put some beds along this wall here. I could put some beds on this wall here. Put a bed here. Put a bed here and here. And that should be plenty of beds for all the prisoners to at least have a place to sleep at night. And of course, all the prisoners have access to the common room right here where they can relax and kind of have fun. He has a screwdriver. That's not a good thing. He's not supposed to have a screwdriver. So we can click on him. We can click search prisoner and a guard will come and search him. And that's how you search a single prisoner. If you want to search an entire room, you can click on the prisoner and search cell, and that will search that prisoner's particular cell. So that's not very good because look at how many cells we have. That's not going to work. We need to be able to search all the prisoners and all the cells and every single cell block in the entire prisoner. And there's an easy way to do that. On the bottom right, there is a red button called Shakedown. Order an immediate search of all cells. This will take some time and annoy the hell out of your inmates. So yeah, it is going to annoy all the inmates. But, you know, that's what we need to do to find all these drugs in the prison. So we're going to call a Shakedown and watch what happens to our guards. Right now we have 17 guards who are not really doing anything out of 40. And I click Shakedown and it's immediately going to drop to zero as soon as all the guards are going to be looking for everything. We already found some drugs, not some drugs, that's liquor, and a screwdriver, and we're going to find more. And we're going to hire more guards to speed this up. I'm going to hire 10 more guards. And we're going to find a lot of contraband, because there's no metal detectors around the prison. We have no way to stop contraband from coming into the prison. We have no dogs to search for drugs. So contraband is a real problem in a prison. So, I mean, we're kind of starting to take care of that, but we have a lot of work to do in order to make this prison a lot cleaner.
Well, on the positive, it's not as bad as it could have been, but there's definitely problems with drugs and alcohol. We need to help these men. The only way of curbing their activities is dealing with the symptoms. Start a drug treatment program in the infirmary. Our doctors will administer a chemical substitute that will help alleviate the cravings in our addicts. For the alcoholics, there isn't a chemical substitute, so I think we should start group therapy. You have to build a common room to run those meetings. To start new programs, go to Reports in the bottom right of the screen, then Programs. Anytime you're unsure what to do, highlight the objective and you'll see additional instructions.
So we built a common room to help prisoners with their needs in recreation, but the common room also serves as a meeting place for basically the Alcoholics Anonymous meetings, and that's what these chairs are for, and I put them in a circle so all the prisoners could sit around in a circle and kind of meet as a community and talk about their problems, especially with alcohol. But in order for these meetings to be held in the first place, they need a time to be able to do it. And so to schedule a time, there's two things that need to happen. There needs to be a spot in the regime
and then there needs to be a program that needs to be run. So let's first start with the regime. To edit the regime, you can click on the schedule right here under the clock that currently says 11:16. And this is the schedule. So this is the schedule of the prison. Right now, you can see from 12 to 6 a.m. is sleep, then there's an hour of shower, a bunch of free time, then our first meal starts at 12. And I don't like that. I like people eating right away. So I can click on eat, and I can change this. So I can have eating earlier in the day. And instead of free time and then lock up and yard, I'm going to switch this to work. Now work, if there's no jobs offered in your prison, work will just be a time for prisoners to do whatever they want. It'll basically be the same as free time. But if there is jobs available in your prison, that means the prisoners have an opportunity to work and they can earn some money and they can develop some skills. And if there's any programs such as the drug treatment program or Alcoholics Anonymous meetings, that will take place during work hours. So you want to put in around 5 consecutive hours of work. The minimum I would recommend is 3. So if you wanted to cut it short, I think the least amount of work you should have is 3 consecutive hours, but I like putting 5 or 6 in. That works really well for me in my experience. And now we have some work time. And because we have work time, we can start scheduling programs. We're going to go and we're going to click on this programs tab right under grants. So here we have this pharmaceutical treatment of drug addiction. Now this is going to cost money every time we run the session, and it's going to take place inside of our infirmary, but this will help drug addicts curb their addiction. So we're going to start, and right here, if we have an infirmary, and if there's work time, and the infirmary isn't being used for anything else, then we'll be able to have this class here. Now if I hit start again and try and open up and keep creating classes, eventually it's going to say all rooms are booked. And this is because each session is 1 hour long. Each session is 1 hour long, and we have six hours that are able to work. So the 7th hour is not going to be able to fit in our schedule because there's only 5 hours a day that will work, and we have them all filled. So we can delete these extra classes here. And of course, if there isn't a room or there's no work time in this regime, then the class isn't going to be offered either. So you need to make sure there's work in the regime and that the room exists and prisoners are able to walk to it. Because if the room is outside the main walls and the prisoners can't walk to it, then they'll say the room's inaccessible. Now I'm going to offer 3 hours of treatment of drugs, and for Alcoholics Anonymous, right here, we're going to start that here, and we can do 2 programs. Of course, each program costs money, but we have so much money we can afford to spend a little extra to help our prisoners with their addictions. So we're going to call from the CEO.
Very good. We've made a real difference here, and I think the prison is back under control. You can stay and improve the prisoner further, or we can move on to the next facility. When you're ready to move on, click on the Polaroid in the infirmary.
And that's right here. That's this Polaroid here. This will end the tutorial. But I'm not done yet, because we have to finish these optional objectives. And we're still in the process of doing our shakedown and searching all our prisoners of all the things. And we're still getting a bunch of contraband. You can see up in the top all the contraband that's been found. Lots of scissors, drugs, spoons, knives, forks, shanks, screwdrivers, cell phones, saws, all the stuff that's like they're not supposed to have. And every time they get caught with something they're not supposed to have, they get an hour of solitary confinement. So solitary is the cells that are really small, really cramped. They don't have any luxuries in them, not even a bed and a toilet. So these cells aren't these cells where the prisoners normally sleep, they're not exactly luxurious, but they're still like they're decently sized for a person, and they have a bed and a toilet, which is really important. Solitary doesn't have to have this at all, and they don't have to have any size requirements. But the only solitary cells we have right now are these 4 right here. And if you look at how many things have been found, we probably have 50 to 60 prisoners who are going to have to go through lockdown or solitary. So we're going to need to build some more solitary confinement cells. So I'm going to go to building brick, and it's going to be 25x4. We're just going to add a little attachment to this building here, and it's just going to be all solitary cells. And I'm going to speed up time so it gets built more efficiently. And don't forget to put some power through this here. If there's no power in the room, none of the lights are going to work. And I think that's it for our shakedown. That means every prisoner, every cell, every hiding spot for things to be hid has been searched. So at this point, all the contraband should be out of the prison. And we need a door for this. For the solitary block, and I'm just going to put a staff door on either end. And there we go, and that's our little solitary wing. We can go to materials, and I'm just going to put in some walls here. And in between each walls is going to be a single solitary cell. So this should be 15 solitary cells. And that will help us, all of the prisoners who get in trouble, have a place to, you know, be punished. Because right now we only have 4, and that's not very many prisoners that we can meet at a time. Here, another Polaroid. Nice. Then we're going to go to objects, solitary door, and each of these cells is going to have a solitary door. It doesn't have to have a solitary door. It could just be a jail door, but solitary doors, despite being, they're more expensive, but they're much stronger. So people in sent to solitary, either violent people or people with drug and alcohol addictions. And finally, there, now we have almost all the doors built. And in order to make them solitary, we need to designate them as solitary in rooms and solitary. As you can see, we have 4 solitaries. Cells, we can click. I'm going to click and drag over here. And if I click and drag, all the walls are going to be ignored. So then I just place all these solitary cells. And there we go. Now we have 16 solitary cells in total. Now look how quickly these solitary cells are going to be filled up with prisoners who have been punished from having stuff they're not supposed to have. Look at just how many are being sent to solitary. Just almost the whole block is filled up. You can see it's only for a short period of time. This prisoner may have been found with a knife, so he's got sent to 2 hours in solitary. This prisoner has found weapons, drugs, and was intoxicated, which explains why there's barf all over the inside of the solitary cell. Ew. But he has a couple hours of solitary. It's not super long, but imagine if each prisoner had to wait in a line and then wait 2 hours. It's much easier if we can serve all the prisoners' punishments at once. For a rule of thumb of how many solitary cells you should have in your prison, take the value of prisoners in your prison. So right now I have 100, and you should have roughly 10 to 20% of that number of solitary cells. So right now I have 100 prisoners, so that'd be 10 to 20 solitary cells. So right now I'm somewhere in the middle with 16, and then look at just how many prisoners have been put back in here. Just so many prisoners are being sentenced to solitary just because there was no limit to the contraband. And so this is kind of a nice thing to have, is because now all these prisoners, because they're in solitary, they're all going to be, almost all of them are going to be suppressed. And when they're suppressed, that means they're going to have a terrible time learning, but they're going to be less likely to create violent action. So they're less likely to get into fights if they're suppressed. So they're more likely to behave. And they're less likely to steal things. They're less likely to cause problems. So it's kind of a risk-reward, because yes, we definitely do not want our prisoners to have problems, but we also want them to be able to learn and adapt from classes, because learning is an important part of improving the quality of your prisoners. It's nice to have nice quality workers, because right now we have a lot of cooks, and we could take some of the work that these cooks are doing and pass it off to prison labor and have the prisoners cook for us. That would be a lot more convenient, and we'd actually make a lot of money from that, and the prisoners would develop lifelong skills that will help them outside of prison. So it's not a good idea to have all your prisoners suppressed, but it's a good idea to have a couple of your violent prisoners suppressed every once in a while. We started these classes to help cure the alcohol, helping the alcoholics and the drug addicts, but it's not going to go really fast. And the reason why is because there's only 4 beds in this infirmary, and that's just not enough. So we're going to make this an infirmary here. So we're going to take this room that was the kitchen, and we're going to make it a second infirmary. So infirmary, there we go. And there we go, we got an infirmary. And we go to objects, we can zoom in, and we have our medical bed. And we're just going to put a bunch of medical beds in. This is an unrealistic amount of medical beds, but it's going to take a really long time for this function to serve. Okay, this is actually too many medical beds. I'm going to delete a row. There we go. That's a little more realistic. There we go. Okay, that's a little better. So now we have this infirmary here. And then we could put some more chairs in the common room. Now, to have more control over scheduling, we can research micromanagement, you need a warden. So I just click micromanagement, and it's going to be researched, and we can double fast forward to that, and we don't have to wait too long. But what that means is I can create schedules for each room. So I can say, hey, I want all the prisoners to come into this room for the psychological treatment of drugs. And why is this room better than this infirmary? Well, the number of beds in the infirmary is how many people can take the class at any one point in time. So the bigger your infirmary and the more beds there are, the more efficient you are with your money, because it costs the same no matter how many people you're treating. So you might as well treat a lot more people. Also, being able to treat people a lot more will be greatly beneficial to increasing the chance of people receiving the treatment they need to be treated for their addiction. And there we go. We have, if you look, we just finished a program right here. And now some of our alcoholics have been, they haven't been cured of their alcoholism, but they've been able to have come up with enough coping mechanisms that they can get a control of it. And of course, in order to have the class, you need to have a psychologist. So if you're starting in sandbox mode, you're going to need to hire a psychologist and do some research for it. All right, micromanagement has been researched, so now we can have more control over scheduling. So we can hit edit schedule, and we can see that there's two infirmaries here, and this is the infirmary that's really bad because it's really small. So we're going to actually schedule some psychological treatment of drugs in this infirmary instead. And we could probably put another alcoholics group here. And I'm going to explain a little bit more of how to use the scheduler in the future, but as you can see, you can just click on a room and then click a program that you can be offered in this room. So right now I just created three more psychological treatments of, I keep saying psychological, it's pharmaceutical treatment of drugs. I'm sorry if you guys are bothering me saying the wrong word. And I just have a lot of money. Like, I'm still making $7,000 per day. So even though I'm hiring a lot of extra doctors and I still have a lot of extra cooks and a lot of extra janitors and gardeners, I don't really care because I'm making enough money that I can compensate for that. And that's it. Our excessive amounts of drug treatment programs have treated, and we've started to help treat those with drug addictions to help be able to curb their addiction, to develop ways to be able to cope with their addiction so they don't have to worry about them anymore. And so that we've done it. We've completed chapter 2 of Prison Architect. We've now picked this prison from a prisoner. We put out the fire, we built a kitchen, we built a canteen, we built a common room and laundry room, and we built an infirmary, and we helped prisoners with all their needs. So let us look at the final cutscene, and then we can say goodbye. Actually, wait. I'm going to do one thing quick. I'm going to go to deployment, and I'm going to deploy a huge number of guards into the infirmary. And this is for kicks and giggles, because you're not allowed to edit. There you go. I have like almost all my guards here. Actually, I'm going to unstation by right-clicking guards in all the other areas of the prison. So I have more guards available to be stationed. I'm going to station as many guards in here as possible. Here we go. We have an insane amount of guards here. I actually hire more guards as well. And oh, that's doctors. Hire more guards as possible. And they're all going to be stationed in this room here. Oh, now I actually have enough guards. I'm just going to get to 100 guards. Deployment. I'm going to deploy some here and an insane amount here as well. And so there's going to be a huge crowd right here. And normally you can't edit anything that involves a cutscene. So this room here, there's a cutscene in this room, so I'm not allowed to edit it. So let's say I wanted to put a chair in this infirmary here. I can't. Even though you normally would be able to, the reason it won't let me is because normally I'd be able to put a chair here, but the game is forcing me to not do so because they don't want me to mess with the cutscene. And so in order to punish the game developers for not letting me mess with the cutscene, I'm going to mess with the cutscene in a way that I know how, which is I can assign guards to this room here. So let us watch the cutscene play out now that we have an insane number of guards right here. Polaroid. There we go. Oh, did it delete all of the guards? No. Oh, no. Okay, so here's a lot of the extra guards in the cell block right before the infirmary, but it got rid of all of the, interesting, I didn't realize that, it got rid of all the guards in the infirmary. Alright, oh, we have our lovely lady coming down the infirmary, they got rid of all the guards in the infirmary. Hey, Vitalia! Uh-oh, what's gonna happen? Oh, we got our Batman villain here. Vitalia! Sweet cheeks, I'm sorry, I messed up. Hush, hush now. They said Pops won't last a week. I know. I came to say goodbye. You know, we could walk away right now. You and me. This life. It's taken everything.
I'd like that.
Bum bum bum.
But I can't. I'm a Palermo, Nico. And with Papa gone and you an outsider in his place, our enemies would walk right over this family. And I can't have that. I need to show that we are still in charge.
What? So you're gonna whack me after all we've been through?
Nico, 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 you're so old school. No, sweetheart, I'm divorcing you.
What? You're kidding me. I'm a dead man in here without the family behind me.
I know, but that's not my concern.
Dun dun dun. Yes, Nico, that little scumbag, he's dead. He tried to kill the father and, you know, take over the family business, but instead he ended up getting divorced by his wife, and now he's probably going to die in this prison. Although, given the huge amount of guards I just purchased, maybe not. Maybe there won't be any problems with fights in this prison now that we have almost more guards than prisoners in this prison. Although we can't see them. They're invisible guards. They're all here still. They're just invisible. Dang, and I was really hoping I'd mess up with the cutscene. I guess they delete the guards in this building right here. So I'm going to have to find ways to mess with the cutscene in the next chapter. But anyway, that's the end for this chapter. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you have any questions, please leave a comment down below. And I look forward to seeing you in the next chapter. Bye!